Welcome back to the Tessonian Age. I'm your host, Durstodon Ensemi, still Zinniop, just a different species. Since we developed English nowadays, we have English names for modern-day animals and complicated scientific names for ancient animals. But if D. Ensemi developed English, what would be their names for their animals? Sorry, Durstodon Ensemi was a weird thing to insert into this premise, but the last video, despite okay views, had insane engagement, so I think you guys get it. I will also recap for those of you who didn't see last week's video, but covering new entries from those groups. Large, bitey theropods like T-Rex and Ceratosaurus are the taus, from the Proto-Indo-European word, the one who bites. Yes, this is a fairly large category, so I could maybe try to split it up. But first, Ceratosaurus is the common tau. I also forgot Carnotaurus last video, so it would be the late Cretaceous bull tau, but back to the Jurassic, Elaphrosaurus is the short-legged tau. Now, I'm going to separate Megalosaurus relatives as spiny taus, Allosaurus relatives as crested taus, and Tyrannosaurus relatives as king taus. With that in mind, Torvosaurus is the giant spiny tau, and Saurophaganax is the Cherokee spiny tau. Allosaurus is just the common crested tau, young Tyrannosaurus is the Chinese crested tau, and Methracanthosaurus is the Dover crested tau. Guanlong is the emperor tau. If you'll recall, pretty much every Cretaceous dinosaur is from the Rockies or the Gobi Desert, but for the Jurassic, you're going to see a lot more from China and Europe. Ankylosaurs are the Avocas, from the Cheyenne word it is crooked. That group is restricted to the Cretaceous. Ceratopsians are the Skimotes, from the Blackfoot three horns. These evolved pretty late, but I will include Chaoyangosaurus as the pygmy Skimote. Dinochirus is the Corkle, from the Turkish word fear hand. Dromaeosaurids are the Rofts, from the Proto-Indo-European word the one who snatches. New additions are the Microraptor, the Chinese flycatcher Roft, and Cynornithosaurus, the tiger Roft. This coloration is actually well attested. Old World hadrosaurs with crests are the Gables, from Proto-Indo-European, the top of the head. New World hadrosaurs are the Missips, from Plains Cree, giant duck. This group didn't exist until the late Cretaceous. Notosaurs are the Scholies, from the Proto-Indo-European word the crooked one, and we have the newly added Hyliosaurus, or the white-horned Scholy. This color is not attested, I just made it up. Ornithomimids are the Ankylornises, from the Greek word eel bird. The earliest of these is Pelicanomimus, which is the toothed Ankylornis. Seriously, look at this mouth. Oviraptorids are the pheasant roughs, because they're kind of like raptors but with a bird's beak, and they're only late Cretaceous. Pachycephalosaurs are the chashus, from the crow word thick head. This time period was when ceratopsians and pachycephalosaurs were diverging, so it's hard to say which one is which. Nevertheless, I will make Yinlong the pygmy chashu. Saltosaurs are the huevulus, from the name of an indigenous American mythological creature. Therizinosaurus is the horful, from Proto-Indo-European, the one who reaps. And troodontids are the tortoise, from Old English word evil tooth. New additions here are May, the sleeping tortoise, and Cynovenator, the grove tortoise. But those are all from the Cretaceous. What about dinosaurs from the Jurassic? No, we already did the intro. I've wasted too much time. Just move. The first new group is the Urfogel, Archaeopteryx. Now, it wouldn't be Ur or Archaeo. It would just be a regular Fogel or fowl in English, but it was found in Germany. Now, at this time, Europe was an archipelago, but we'll try to work with what we have. Archaeopteryx, to me, resembles other birds too much, so I won't give it a unique name until Proto-West Germanic, at which point it becomes arrow tail. There are many words for both of these, but the one I'm going with are Wibr and Thagl. I believe these would come together as Wivthagl, with the ending R being interpreted as a north-ending stem R, which is lost in English. I'm also not 100% sure how this would compact into modern English. Wifftail is the most conservative, but whiftel also seems possible, the T becoming silent like it does in thistle, and mostly soften. I'm content with whiffle, so Archaeopteryx is the black-backed whiffle. This color is something we're confident about, looking at some well-preserved feathers, and now we get into some taxonomic messiness. So the next group of dinosaurs we'll be discussing all fall around the common ancestor of T-Rex and birds. Pretty much anything that doesn't neatly fit into one of these eight groups is labeled Coeluridae, which makes it what's called a wastebasket taxon. But Coeluridae itself is relatively unadulterated, so Coeluridae is found in America, specifically Wyoming, because I like bouncing around between languages, we'll do Shoshone. Coeluridae means hollow tail, which in Shoshone cows together as something like Guashihoo or Guesikono. I won't worry about tail, and I prefer the version of hollow with h because it's easier to drop off, so the intermediate step in French, if I want to go that route, might be Gassiav, or some equivalent, giving the English gashave. So, of the two, Coeluridae is the peaceful gashave, and Ornitholestes is the robber gashave. Now, if you paused when I had this cladogram up earlier, you may notice that we've named most of these groups already, with the one exception of Compso. Compsognathids are similar to the Gashaves, but are overall smaller, faster, and more from Europe. Now, even if they are relatively quintessential, the English words for a lot of reptiles have changed constantly, with us currently using Anglo-Norman words for turtle and lizard. So, let's bust out the Latin toolkit. The simplest place to go is lizard standing on two legs. In Latin, that will be lacerta with some participle. I imagine lacerta gets cut off and only the participle remains, which is very much precedented, so that deserves the bulk of my focus. The word for standing is stans, which is just eton in French or stant in English, so I'm inclined to add some sort of prefix. Of course, I am a tad bit limited because distant, extant, constant, and instant are all already existent, but ad, meaning it stands towards, is fine, so astant seems alright to me. Compsognathus is the white-bellied astant, while Spinosaurus is the banded astant. We have those patterns on pretty good authority. Next up, we got your main man, the Diplodocids. Now, the five major species are all only found in North America, but we do have Dinosaurs from Portugal. To split the difference, I'm going to go with Tornieria, which is found in Tanzania. So I'll start in Arabic by calking the Brontosaurus. That gives Raid Tanin, Thundering Dragon. This most likely goes into Italian as Raidanino or Raidani, or maybe it actually is compacted to Redanino. This development is all very similar to how we got giraffe, so I'm partial to an analogous Redane. So in order, Brontosaurus is the Thundering Redane, Apatosaurus is, of course, the False Thundering Redane, Supersaurus is the Giant Mountain Redane, Barosaurus is the Stout Redane, and Diplodocus is the Double-Tailed Redane. I started this paragraph off with in order, and then there never was an order. Next up, it's everyone's favorite dinosaur that you've never heard of, the Dryosaurs. Dryosaurs are an extinct branch. Okay, all dinosaur branches are extinct, but they didn't make it to the late Cretaceous. Their closest relatives are hadrosaurs. They are small, herbivorous, fast-moving ornithopods, a niche relatively comparable to modern-day mouse deer. These are native to Europe, so perhaps more comparable to rabbits or rodents. Rabbit is Anglo-Norman in origin, with rat from Old English. How about this split the difference? Latin to Old English to English. There are a few words that do this, like pile and the prefix arch. So, using Diplodocus as the calc, which means uncaptured, we have Incaptus. Over to Proto-West Germanic, we would loan that as Incaptur. If that gets reanalyzed as a two-syllable root stressed on the first syllable, we would see Inchaft for Old English, for Modern English, Inchift. So Dryosaurus is the forest inchift, Camptosaurus is the crooked inchift, Diplodocus is the Tanganyika inchift, and Valdosaurus is the Channel Islands inchift. A close relative, Hypsilophodon, is next, which I'm just going to do unadulterated from Proto-Indo-European. It's hard to imagine what's so special about Hypsilophodon that makes it a one-word name, but I think my best option is related to its skipping or dancing, relating to its style of movement, which would presumably be unique, I guess. Anyway, the two best roots for this are lek and leg, which are very similar, so I'm going to go with an E-grade version with nos as the ending, which becomes some intermediate form like leknos, and more importantly, it's lichnaj in Proto-Germanic. Old English, lean, Modern English, line. That's too simple. Maybe we give it a prefix. Hypsilophodon means high-crested tooth, so I'm going to go with high, also because I know its development is irregular, as we can see in the spellings of height and heifer. So we could go with hayline, whether that's pronounced the same as highline or not, which is what I think I will do. So Hypsilophodon is the common highline. Iguanodon is the direct ancestor of hadrosaurs that I was talking about earlier. They were found all across Europe, and although Iguanodon is not an inaccurate name, it doesn't reflect the most notable feature, which was misidentified at the time. Its most notable feature is the thumb and the hands in general, so I'm going to call it Mrs. Five, Punquis. This root is also used in finger. In Proto-Germanic, that's funguige, that umlauts and also palatalizes, Old English funge. Iguanodon can be the Frisian finge. Hey, I'm getting pretty good at this. Next up is Macronaria, the big tall sauropods with necks that go up, as opposed to the Diplodocids, who have necks that go across. At least that's a difference I internalized. Most of these are from North America, but we do have Mamenchisaurus from China, so I'll go with a Sanskrit name, and we'll try to ignore that India is not yet attached to the rest of Asia. Now, Macronaria is named after the size of their nostrils, which doesn't seem like the most relevant part of them unless you're explicitly comparing them to other sauropods. Mamenchisaurus is named after where it was found, so I'll just call it something sappy like the Cathedral of Flesh. That's kind of similar to Camarasaurus. Now, the Hindu equivalent of a cathedral would be a mandir, and flesh is mansa, with the sum ending for the genitive alternative case, but I'd like to compress it into Mandirman, which can also be read as cathedral-like. So Brachiosaurus is the Colorado Mandirman, Camarasaurus is the Redwood Mandirman, Yanentia is the Savannah Mandirman, Jobaria is the Congo Mandirman, and Mamenchisaurus is the Indian Mandirman. Spinosaurs are a bit too late for this time period, but screw it, I don't care anymore. I'm evolving into Eomyascansauria. Now, the Spinosaurs that actually have a spine, namely Spinosaurus and Oxalea, are still too late, but we do have the semi-aquatic Baryonyx and Ichthyovenator, both of which hunt fish. That's probably fine, though I would have wanted a different name for them anyways, or will, probably, we'll see. Now, Baryonyx at least is from Europe, so I'll give it an Indo-European name. So the word for hedgehog used in echidna is often compared to snake, giving an etymology something like the snake eater. Now, fish is pescos, so maybe we could make Spinosaurus as poiskos, except I want it to be feminine, so poiske. Point being, that becomes Proto-Germanic faisco into Old English fash, Modern English foch. Okay, maybe that's too close to fish, so I'll add in the standard chicken suffix, which unfortunately does umlaut the vowel, so we'll get feshen. So Baryonyx is the Mediterranean feshen, and Ichthyovenator is the Javanese feshen. And that leaves one happy family I've been clickbaiting until the end. Hey, it's not my fault it came last alphabetically. Let's go on to the Stegosaurs. Stegosaurus means roof lizard. Of course, Proto-Indo-European doesn't have a word for roof, so I'm going to put together the two words skoiskros, which means needle back. Actually, this root doesn't mean back, it means bent, but it relates to back in a lot of languages, most notably ridge and cortex. This all comes together as Proto-Germanic skoiskuraj, but skua doesn't exist in Proto-Germanic, so I imagine it's lost, and we get huiskuraj. That becomes Old English huaskur into Modern English washer. Potentially without palatalization by analogy to whisker, but that is from Norse. So Stegosaurus is the kite-backed washer, Kentrosaurus is the spiny washer, and Decentrurus is the thorny tail washer. And that's the late Jurassic. Until next time, Eomyascansauria is evolving into Homo sapiens. By the way, I wasn't joking last time. I did write a fanfic about Ben Shapiro and Zoran Mamdani. I think it's pretty good, even though it's more high fantasy than, like, in romance.